Okay, good morning class. This is our subject for organization and management. I'm still your professor for this subject. I'm Father Joel Villanueva, OSJ, your school director. Now, before we begin our class, let us pray in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for all the blessings that you have given us. Thank you for the gift of wisdom. Thank you for the gift of the family. Thank you for the gift of good health. Thank you for all those people who are helping us achieve our dreams. Thank you for the many blessings, even if those blessings are undeserved. And we ask for forgiveness for the many sins that we have committed, and hope you will enlighten us and guide us towards the right path of our life. All this we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Again, good morning, class. I hope you have watched all our previous videos and you were able to follow our discussions. The last time, we discussed about the classical theories of management. For today, we shall discuss about the neoclassical management theories, and then later on we shall discuss what are the different modern management theories. Now, the focus of the neoclassical theories are the importance of human relations and behavior in trying to manage people. Well, remember, in management we are managing people, and in this neoclassical, they now come to the realization that people are the most important factor in the success of every organization, of every company, of every industry. Without people, then our goal for the company will definitely not be met. Now, in the classical period, from 1900 to 1930s, we have realized that they give so much emphasis on scientific methods. They give so much emphasis on the machine, to the point that they look down on human persons as just like ordinary machines. What matters is that they produce something. Now, they were missing the point. That's why here in this period, from 1930s to 1950s, they want to give emphasis or importance on the role of the people. That's why, as I've said, human relations, the relationship between co-employees, the relationship between the employee and the manager was given importance. And the human behavior, how human as we are, will react to the different motivational factors that will be given to us. Because in the classical period, they thought that money was the only motivation why we work. Pagtaas ng sweldo mo, di pagsipag mo. But here, they realize hindi lamang pera. At tama yan. Hindi lamang sa pera tumatakbo ang buhay ng tao. Sabi nga, ang tao, titigil yan sa iyo kahit kakunti ang maliit ang sweldo, basta pakisamahan mo ng tama. Pero kahit na malaki ang sweldo niyan, kapag kayan ay hindi mo naman pinakikisamahan ng tama, walang mabuting relasyon na nabubuo, aalis at aalis sa kumpanya. Kaya ganyan din sa paaralan natin, di ba? Kahit maliit ang sweldo ng maraming nating mga teachers, but with the right motivation, with the good relationship with one another, then we are able to encourage our teachers to stay with us. Now, let us see the different neoclassical theories. In neoclassical theories, the focus, as I've said, was the behavior. Behavioral management theories ushered in the human relations view to management approximately in the 1930 to 1950. These theories aim to satisfy social relations and personal fulfillment to motivate employees to seek their best performance. Behavioral approach is people-oriented. You see, in the classical, they were product-oriented. They were end-oriented, but here, the difference is, they are now people-oriented. They are giving importance to the employees, the human behavior, the motivations on how they will work. It's not about the money, it's all about the people. Now, who are the main proponents? The first proponent of behavioral approach was Elton Mayo. He was a forerunner of the behavioral movement in management. And Elton Mayo was known in what we call Hawthorne Studies in the 1930s. Hawthorne, Hawthorne, Hawthorne Studies. This Hawthorne study was a product of an experiment on the different people, on the different workers, on how they will react to the different motivations. They tried the different motivations such as the music, you see, while they are working, they have to put some music, will they perform well? Now, also the right temperature, kapag ka ba aircon ang kanilang ginagalawan, hindi masyadong mainit, o kung malamig sa labas, medyo bigyan mo ng konting temperature para makagawa ng mabuti. These external motivations, it also includes the proper compensation scheme. Bagamat binigyan ng pansin ito sa classical yung sweldo, pero dito, there is the proper compensation scheme na yung mahirap ang trabaho, bigyan mo ng konting incentives, and then yung may mga special assignment, you put some proper compensation. And then, they adjust the number of working hours. Hindi pwedeng trabaho ka parang kabayo. Let's say, putting 8 hours work only for the day para bigyan ng pagkakataon ang mga manggagawa para makapagpahinga din. That's part of the Hawthorne Studies. Now, Hawthorne Study has different phases. It has 4 phases actually. The first one was the illumination stage, wherein they put proper light on the working place. And they come to realize that with proper light, workers will work well and better. The preference on lighting level was subjective. If they were told it was good, they believe it and prefer it, and vice versa. It was here that the researchers realized something else besides lighting was affecting the productivity. You see? Of course, proper lighting will help. But sabi nga dito, pag sinabi ng manager, okay na yan, naniniwala sila. But there is more than light. More than the illumination, more than the physical lighting. There is the second phase, the relay assembly room experiment. Now, what they do with the relay experiment? What they did was, they were giving the workers work harder because they thought that they are being supervised and monitored. On the relay experiment, naandun yung may mga parang may magbabantay sa kanila, may mag-o-observe. O sa ngayon, may mga CCTV cameras tayo, merong mag-monitoring. You see, daily basis monitoring or every 2 hours monitoring. Kasi ayon sa theory, kapag alam ng workers na sila ay binabantayan, which alam natin hanggang sa ngayon, kapag binabantayan, they perform well. Kaya nga, when workers thought that they are being monitored, they work harder. So that's the relay stage. Now, the third stage was the experiment in interview working. In interview, they concluded that prior life experience had an important influence on the work attitudes. Kaya nga sa interview, tingnan mo kumusta ang kanyang pamilya, kumusta ang dati niyang trabaho, kumusta ang kanyang makasamahan. Interview in this third phase was very important kasi doon mo makikilala yung tao. Kasi hindi naman robot ang iyong in-employ. Tao, may karanasan, may mga experiences. Ito ba ay makakatulong? Ito ba ay makakasagabal? Yung bang kanyang makaranasan, kabiguan sa love life, di ba? Minsan, hindi makapagtrabaho ng husay kasi nabigo sa pag-ibig. O kaya naman, may problema sa pamilya, hindi makapagtrabaho ng husay. Now, these experiences, they have great influence in the work attitudes. And that employees felt more positive about the work environment when an interviewer or superior showed interest. In other words, personal life stories. You have to listen. Pakinggan mo ano bang sinasabi ng iyong mga trabahador, ng iyong mga manggagawa. Hindi sila robot. May kwento sa likod ng bawat tao na ini-employ natin. And then number 4th phase, yung bunk wiring room experiment. Dito, the main purpose was to find out how payment incentives would affect the group productivity. And surprisingly, they found out that they have no effect at all. You see, nakita nila dito na hindi lamang pera-pera ang mga manggagawa. Ang mga tao, ang mahalaga sa kanila, yung tamang pakikisama, yung good environment. Kaya nga sa first stage, illumination phase, lagyan nila ng ilaw, tamang ilaw, nagtrabaho sila, pero hindi sila tumigil doon. Pangalawang stage, naandun yung supervision, yung bank relay, na may nag-motivate, may nagsusupervise. Kapag alam nila na sila ay pinapanood, sila ay gumagawa ng mabuti. Yun yung relay assembly room experiment. At third phase, ito yung interview. Kilalanin mo. At sa panghuli, bank wiring room. Kaya bank wiring room, ito yung tumutukoy sa compensation o sa tamang sweldo. Now, what are the results of these Hawthorne studies by Elton Mayo, the forerunner of behavioral movement? Unang-una, anong napatunayan niya? Number one, on motivation. That employees are not motivated only by money. Bonus na lamang yon, syempre. Pero, people work not just because of money. Yan ang kanilang napatunayan. Money is not the only motivation. Pangalawa, communication. Communication helps the management and the employees to have a better mutual understanding. Through proper communication, the management can easily identify the problem faced by its employees. That's why interview was very important. Number three, social factors. Responsible for deciding the level of output. Social factors mean to say, yung relasyon ng manggagawa sa kapwa manggagawa at relasyon ng manggagawa sa mga ng manggagawa sa kanilang mga managers. You see? Social factors. And number four, behavioral factors. Workers are not as individual identity, but as members of group in organization. That is why how an individual behave may affect the behaviors of others. Now, from this Hawthorne result, another emphasis given was relationship. There is a need to establish good relationship. Kaya nga, di ba, meron tayong, anong nangyayari? May team building. Ano, di ba, magtataka, meron kaming team building. Merong recollections. Binibigyan din ang mga manggagawa ng pagkakataon na magkaroon ng mga outing. All of this may not be easily grasp as important, pero ayon dito sa Hawthorne study by Elton Mayo, it gives importance on relationship. And then on the production level, the teamwork and group psychology increases productivity. Teamwork! Hindi pwedeng ang tao ay gagawa lamang na mag-isa. Teamwork was given emphasis and group activities. Now, in this Hawthorne studies by Elton Mayo, it showed the complexity of group relationship. That human relations, behavior of each individual, are very important in management. Now, another theory which was developed by Chester Barnard, the father of cooperative system, according to Chester Barnard, he said that he compared management into an airport. That you see in airport, kung nakapunta kayo sa airport, di ba? Every system works and they work dependently on one another. Kapag pumalya ang isa, sigurado papalya din yung iba. Kita nyo yung pag-landing na lamang ng aeroplano, yung communication mula dun sa tower, yung mga tao dun sa baba, yung para sa pagdating, kukuha ng mga gamit, etc. There must be communication. Sabi nga dito, the father of cooperative systems. Every division, every part of the company must work together towards a single goal. According to Chester Barnard, subordinates assess legitimacy of managers' directives and decide whether or not to comply based on their acceptance of authority, usually done without conscious thought. You see, dito sa cooperative system, there must be one good manager who must be good enough to make the different systems work together. May isang mangunguna, may isang magli-lead upang ang lahat ng mga sistema ay gumawa ayon doon sa layunin ng organisasyon. So, they comply on the acceptance of the authority. Kapag hindi mo kinikilala ang authority, hindi magpa-function. Diba, sa bahay ninyo, pag hindi nyo kinikilala ang authority ng inyong magulang, sigurado ako, magkakagulo kayo. Mag-aaway-aaway kayo, mga magkakapatid. Hindi magkakaroon ng kapayapaan. There must be an authority that must be considered someone who is trustworthy, someone who is capable of inspiring, someone who is capable of leading the group, the family, the community, the company towards the attainment of the goal. Now, we have another theory, the Douglas MacGregor. He developed the theory X and the theory Y for managing people. Theory X and theory Y. What is this theory X? Here, the theory X managers, meron tinatawag na theory X at merong X. Who are the X managers? Accordingly, the X managers, it says here, that average employees dislikes work and will avoid it. And daw, ang mga, according to theory X managers, most employees must be coerced and closely supervised. Most employees have little ambition and are mostly interested in job security. And most employees avoid responsibilities. Now, from this theory X, we may say that the manager is kind of negative in his approach towards the employees. That they dislike work, that they must be coerced, kailangan pilitin mo pa, that they have little ambition, that they lack responsibility. But the theory Y managers, he looked on the employees from the different perspective. It says that physical and mental effort in work is as neutral as play or rest. Ano? Wala ditong kinalaman yung ugali ng iyong mga employees. Ibig sabihin, sabi nga dito, they play neutral as play or rest. Most people prefer to exercise self-direction and self-control. You see? Medyo nagiging positibo ang tingin. Sabi doon sa X, mga kailangan pilitin mo. Sabi ng theory Y, no. They have self-direction. They have self-control. And people learn when encouraged to accept and seek responsibilities. Ang kailangan lamang ayon sa theory Y is the proper motivation, the proper direction to be given. At naniniwala ako dyan din. Diba? Gabayan mo lamang. Ang mga tao gagawa yan, if they are inspired, if they believe in your cause, if they believe in your mission, if they believe in your vision, you need to coerce them to work with you. Kasi they themselves could see where is it going. Now, people are interested in displaying imagination, ingenuity, and creativity to solve organizational problems. In other words, they are willing to put forward and give their special talents because they can see the direction where the group, where the company is going. So sa theory X, kind of negative on employees, on people because of the negative, seemingly negative traits of the employees. But here in the theory Y, it looks on the employees as somewhat positive. They only need the right motivation, the right leader who will lead them towards the achievement of the goal. Now, that's the theory X and the theory Y. Now, let's come with another motivational proponent who is in the name of Abraham Maslow. He is the father of hierarchy of human needs. According sa kanya, kay Abraham Maslow, tayo daw, siyempre, lahat naman ng tao may pangangailangan. But there is what we call hierarchy of needs. It's like a pyramid. Ano? Sa pyramid, you have to have a good foundation, di ba? Like triangle. Kinakailangan matibay yung pundasyon mo. Hindi magiging matatag ang iyong pyramid if you don't have a strong foundation. And according to Abraham Maslow, the bottom of the pyramid, which is the foundation, is what we call the physiological needs of the people. Yung breathing, yung food, water, sleep, basically the physiological needs. Kailangan para ang isang tao ay magawa, makagawa ng mabuti, mamit mo muna yung pangangailangan ng kanyang katawan. Hindi nga ba? Pagka gutom ang mag-aaral, paano yung mag-aaral? Ika nga. Paano yung makikinig? Gutom. Ika nga. The physical needs, everything, all the physiological needs must be met because physiological needs are the foundation of everything. Ganun din naman sa, di ba? Paano mo ma-i-encourage ang tao na magbago, magbalik loob sa Diyos? Dinggin mo muna ang pangangalam ng kanyang tiyan. Baka gutom. Now, next to that is the safety needs. If the bottom is physiological needs, pangailangan ng katawan, on top of it is what we call safety needs. The security of the body, of employment, of resources, and of morality, of the family, of health, of property. Kaya nga, di ba? Ang tao, kailangan ka lang may security of tenure sa trabaho. Pag walang kasiguraduhan ang tao, aalis at aalis yan. Hindi niya alam kung bukas ba may trabaho pa siya. Bukas ba may uuwian pa siyang pamilya. Security. Seguridad sa lahat ng bagay. Kasi without security, anong sabi natin? You will be insecure. And if you are insecure, if you feel that you are less secure in life, hindi magkakaroon ng maayos na paggawa. That's the on top of the physiological needs. On top of it is what we call the love and belonging. Kailangan, maramdaman mo din. Friendship, family, and intimacy. That's on top of the security. Pag na-fulfill mo na yung pangangailangan ng katawan, physiological needs, punta ka doon sa ikalawang bahagdan, yung tinatawag natin na security needs. Pag na-fulfill mo na yung security needs, saka pa lang yung love. Kaya nga, ang isang tao, di ba, sabi nga, pag hindi yan secure sa kanyang sarili, hindi secure sa kanyang buhay, hindi niyan mapapansin muna ang pangangailangan ng pag-ibig, pangangailangan ng pamilya, pagkaibigan, kasi hindi siya secure. Kaya iba, bakit? Kailan daw sila mag-aasawa? Kapag ka-established na, secure na sila. You see? It comes on the third level, according to Abraham Maslow. On top of that is what we call the self-esteem. Ito naman, nandito naman yung kanyang paniniwala sa kanyang sarili. Yung kanyang lakas ng loob, tibay ng loob. Kapag ka na-fulfill mo na yung pag-ibig, pakikipagkaibigan, lumalakas ang tiwala mo sa iyong sarili. And on top of this, on top of this hierarchy of needs, is what we call self-actualization. Nasa taas ng triangle, yung tinatawag na self-actualization. Yan yung morality, creativity, spontaneity, problem-solving, lack of prejudice, and acceptance. Ibig sabihin ng self-actualization, siya na ito, nakamit na niya yung tagumpay. Wala na yung insecurities, nado na yung kanyang bilang creative, nado na yung kanyang moral stature bilang tao. You see, this is Abraham Maslow. Nasa ilalim ng pyramid, yung unang physiological needs. I-met mo muna yung pangangailangan ng katawan. Then security needs. Pagkatapos ng security needs, nado yung love. And belongingness, on top of love, belongingness, yung steam. And then yung on top of that, self-actualization. In other words, self-actualization happens when all the different levels have been met. Now, let us go with the fifth proponent in behavioral theory. Chris Argyris, the developer of the theory of adult personality. According to Chris Argyris, there is a need to understand why the expected outcome does not parallel with the actual outcome. And so we have to inquire, we have to ask, we have to understand. That's why here on the adult personality, we have to understand why a person is acting that way. We have to fill the gap doon sa ipinapakitang ugali ng bawat isa. So, ito yung tinatawag natin na neoclassical. The focus on the character of the person. Ngayon, tingnan natin naman. After that, pumasok tayo sa modern management theories. Now, modern management from 1950 up to the present time. So, ulitin ko ha. Yung classical, that's from 1900 to 1930. yung neoclassical from 1930 to 1950, na kung saan ang focus na nga is human relationship and human behavior. Now, in modern management theories, the modern management involves several views and technique. One of them is the use of quantitative analysis. When we say quantitative analysis, we deal with numbers. We deal with facts. We deal with the percentages. We deal with the numbers of those people who are really working and the numbers of the that matters to the organization. Yan. And tools in business. Quantitative, it deals with numbers. Another approach to modern management system is the view of the organization. Today's organization is viewed as an open system. It's an open system. Ibig sabihin, hindi lamang ikaw na manager, ikaw lang lagi ang masusunod. Hindi lamang ikaw, hindi lamang isang sistema. Open to the different opportunities, open to the different suggestions, open to the different methods that may be employed in order to greatly achieve the goal of the organization. There is this an open system that interacts with the environment to transform inputs into outputs. Lahat ng mga suggestion galing sa labas, from hindi lang sa loob ng organization. Halimbawa, ang paaralan natin, suggestion from the students, suggestion from the parents, suggestion from the government, from the barangay, from the health, etc. Kasi nga, no company, no community is independent. Tingnan natin, lahat ng grupo, ito'y konektado sa iba pang grupo. Marami lamang tayong mga sistema, marami lamang tayong mga division upang mas mapagaan natin. Pero, we don't work in isolation. Remember this, no organization, no company, no business will work independently. Kahit sabihin mong kaya mong mabuhay, hindi. Halimbawa, kahit ang tinda mo ay isawan, di ba? Isaw lamang ang tinda mo. Eh, saan kakukuha ng supplier mo? Saan kakukuha ng uling? Kailangan may supplier ka. Saan kakukuha ng manok? Yung kuryente, yung mga sawsawan, di ba? Meaning to say, there are many systems that must be involved in order for us to have one output. It is a collaboration of many systems. That's why it is an open system. There is also contingency thinking as contribution to modern management. Under this approach, unique situations are matched with unique managerial responses such that in effect, there is no one way to management. Sabi dito, tandaan niyo, unique situation will need unique managerial responses. Ibig sabihin, management is not one size fits all. Doon sa classical, ganun ang tingin nila. There is only one right way to manage. But in modern management, there is no single management approach because every situation is unique that needs unique way of management. There is no one way to management. Now, sino-sino dito yung mga proponents? Basahin ko na lang sa inyo, nasa kopya ninyo. Edward Deming, the father of quality movement. Joseph Duran, the father of equality principle, of plan, control, improve. Peter Drucker, father of modern management. Peter Senge, father of learning organization. Jeffrey Pfeiffer, developer of evidence-based management. Robert Sutton, American professor and researcher. And Michael Porter, the father of competitive strategy. Now, all these proponents, all these modern management theories are conglomeration or combination of the different management systems in order for them to arrive into a particular goal or vision or mission. So that the vision of the organization will be met through the different missions which will be applied, which will use different applications of strategic methods to attain the goals. So, ang ibig sabihin ko lamang dito, sa modern management hanggang sa kasalukuyan natin, maraming mga methodology tayo na ginagamit. It is not one size fits all. So, sana sa ating different theories na ito, classical theories, neoclassical theories, and the modern methods, nakita natin. Sa neoclassical, focus sila doon sa attainment of a perfection of the output without giving much emphasis on the people. Dito naman sa neoclassical, it gives emphasis on the role of the people. Dito sa modern management, hindi lamang yung output, hindi lamang yung tao, kundi maraming sistema ang dapat magtulungan upang ma-achieve natin ang isang magandang success ng organization. So, as we go along our discussion, we will proceed in our next discussion on the different roles of the managers. And all of these theories will be discussed in our future discussions. And I hope you will be more willing enough to try what do you think is the best managerial method that you will employ when you become manager yourselves. So, I hope you learned something today. God bless you. Pagpalain kayo ng ating Panginoong Diyos. In the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Glory to the Father, to the Son, to the Holy Spirit. As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.